I think that changing your mind and looking at things differently and maybe doing things differently demands so much out of you, and people who working so many years in corporate would find it a bit like intimidating, even like, right, this is what we've done till now. We got like, yeah, you're great. We got lots of like, you know, the best worker, the best employee, operation excellence, all that. And now you're telling me it's not enough. Now maybe you need to do something different, or as a company, we need to do something different.
Yeah.
And I think that most people would not want to change. It's very hard to change.
Absolutely. And so if you think about it in that way, is that the team and the business needs to go into new opportunities, which is exciting, but also very uncertain. How would this work out? You change the relationships within the company of how you work together, which creates a new power balance. It's about money and investments and all that type of thing. And we also actually say some old processes need to die in order to make the new work. So if you all frame that up, let's say sum it up, wow, that's a lot of things that you need to, next to the metrics, next to the process, next to, you know, and then also need to build that product, you need to make it big. So that's a lot. And therefore, I feel that the success is not only in talking about the hard things, but even maybe more about, are we equipped? Are we training our venture builders in working on all these different levels at the same time? And that creates a lot of emotions. It creates a lot of emotions in the team, between the team and the management. And how do you manage that, right? And are we training our people to do that actually? I think that's also a big piece to work on.
Yeah, what you're saying about the emotions, I think it's related to fear of change. People are, they don't like to change. And when you really try to pressure them, it's not good, because if they don't understand why should it be and really change from within, you cannot pressure them to do it. And if it's really hard for a company to do, how could it be under such a pressure? They know that there is a change and the change is faster and accelerating. And now they need to do it in parallel to other things. They're like making their stakeholders as happy as a year in 2019. And all of the things that are expected from them, like usually in the normal business.
Yeah. And what is interesting is what you say is that, hey, how do we make the management happy? I would say, look, we are not in the business of making them happy, but that's important to mention. So what happens if they are not happy? Which is most of the time the case, because all the numbers are very small, right? So distrust, for example, and how do you work with that? How do you, and that is for me such a crucial thing, and that if you sort of are not aware that that is actually taking place, you cannot also really intervene on that, right? And most of the TED Talks are about creating positive energy, creating trust. Well, I completely agree. But the reality is that when you start building new ventures, there's more distrust that people don't talk about, but it's actually there. So how do we work with that? How do we help our venture builders work in such an environment to make sure still the new big business is, you know, coming out of there? And I think that's just something, super relevant.
I think that what you're saying about the distrust is something that, like, you know, we're talking about what should be and not how can we tackle things that are currently in our business.
In the reality, right? What's happening here in reality, you know, because if we're not sharp on, hey, who are involved in the meeting? How do people look? What do they say? What do they don't say? How can we manage this? You know, all that. You need to be, as a venture builder nowadays, you need to be equipped to do a lot of things.
It seems that we're talking mainly about the soft skills of leaders. Yeah. And, you know, it's really strange that this is so, like at the top of what needs to be done is really understanding people first. And then you could operate with these like resources. And many people think about leaders like, having a vision, knowing the numbers, handling the business. They are less thinking about them as really understanding people, the way they think, the dynamic within the team and within the company, and who would even anticipating what's going to be the reaction of each of these like entities when they do it. Yeah. And it's really demanding from you as a leader, especially if you're not sure, like, because there are so many uncertainties, you're probably not sure. You believe in something, but you're not sure that that's the right thing.
And you know, Eddie, how it works. If you are not sure about what you're telling me, then I would feel that.
Yeah.
And that will color my perception of what you're actually trying to tell me. And then the data can be fantastic, but I still do not disconnect it from you as a person, right? So yeah, it's super important. And what is also interesting about what you see in the leadership literature or work is that, like you said, you need to have a vision, you need to take the people on board, et cetera, et cetera. But for every argument, for every statement, I can also make the flip side of it. So what if you don't have a vision? I can also come up with arguments in which that also might work. So leadership is always very context driven, right? And that's what it makes, I think one of the top things for venture builders to work on yourself, your personal leadership skills. Where do I block as a person and why? Yeah, what does this tell me about myself? It doesn't have, because you filter your reality, right? You have this filter going on, which you create from, early childhood, et cetera, et cetera. That's all known. But so how do I filter my perception? And is this actually the right type of interpretation in the sense, does this bring me any further?
Yeah, it seems that they have so many demands from leadership these days in general, but these days even further, because what was stable for maybe 10 years or 20 years in the past now it could be stable only for 3 years, I would say.
So
you know, I'm thinking a lot about, I have 4 kids, and I always think, like, what do they need to know and what are their skills and capabilities? And I think that the main thing that would come to my mind is the way you handle change. You need to know how to handle change, because everything is so much faster and faster. And when they'll go to be in a company and really be an employee and maybe some days maybe grow within the company, they need to know that there is only one constant, which is change. Yeah. And we see that even further right now.
Yeah, I totally agree. And that basically what we a little bit touched upon is also the dark side of change. Right. So what happens when you start changing things? Yeah, not everybody is hallelujah, you know? Not everybody.
Most of them are not.
Yeah, but we are not talking about it a lot, you know, and that's so interesting. So we always try to, we need to be positive and a good energy. But what if people are mentally not there, you know, because, you know, there's so many there's so many uncertainty, there is fear, there is excitement at the same time. Super interesting. So agree, our children should also work on these personal leadership skills next to whatever competency is at that moment in time when they're big relevant.
Yeah, I think when we're thinking about really handling these challenges within the company, which is a major thing. It's not like 5% of what's going on is people depressed or feeling anxious and talking next to the coffee machine. I think it's like much more than that. I wouldn't say even 50% sometimes, depends on the company and the people, of what is preventing you from doing things that you believe that maybe right now we don't see the value, but we could see the value in the future. And especially if you're not interested in changing these people, sometimes you can say, okay, this department is not really able to adjust and maybe we should change him. But I guess that most leaders would prefer to have the expertise and knowledge that these people had through the years and leave them within the company. And therefore, these people needs this capability to do things differently.
Correct. And one other important element, and that's a bit less on the personal leadership skills, but it's about fundraising. So let's say within our company, I'm putting this mindset in place, let's say, or work on that for my own colleagues and also at the client side, is that, look, in essence, we are fundraising. And then fundraising within a corporate environment. So how can we find data from the market, from the consumer in lean startup, build, measure, learn, rapid prototyping way of working, so that in the end, when we create an investment deck in which we clearly state, backed up by evidence, this is the customer, there are so many customers out there, we have a product, we validated it, we sold the product, the price point is good, the viability makes sense, let's say from a first estimation, it's scalable, it fits a brand, boom, boom, all these checks, boom, boom, boom. And then a great pitch with a very confident entrepreneurial minded person, and then asking for the next round of investment. And then what I see happening, Eddie, is that, yeah, let's ask a 200K. No, 5 million. Also put there some bold. So you need to help the teams also think a bit bigger. And what do you really need to make it big? And if you ask such a small number, I'm already skeptical. Well, is that because you don't really believe in this idea or what we have, or you are afraid that the number is too big and that somebody else rigged? In essence, it's driven by fear.
Yeah. You never know. Like, it could be like too much or too little. Until you get the answer, you don't know. And it's the same for any entrepreneur who will go to a VC and say, like, this is what we understand from the market, we need this amount.
Exactly.
And they need to know what is the meaning of that amount. And especially within a corporate, I'm not sure that there are so many people adjusted to saying 5 million. I need 5 million. How many people within the company is like so used to saying that number? Maybe someone from sales or from marketing, I don't know. But as a industry leader, as a knowledge expert, usually you're doing what you're doing. You're not used to talking about these numbers. Correct. And to be sure about it.
Yeah, correct.